So other countries, different things are happening. Do you know that in Russia, they want to actually send a mission to deflect Apophis? They actually are prepared to fund that. That picture that I drew and did my little dance, that's not funded. That's just ideas on a page. Russia actually wants to fund it. And they invited us to participate. And I said, well, sure. But then I thought about it. I was asked by the NewsHour, what are my top 10 news stories of the year? This was now end of 2009. What are my top 10? I said, I don't have 10 stories, I have 5. Okay, what are they? I said, one of them is Russia inviting us to join them to deflect Apophis. They said, why? I said, here's why. Why is Russia creating the spaceship that's going to deflect Apophis, which, if it hits, wipes out the west coast of the United States? Aren't we the ones who are supposed to fund that mission and then invite others to participate? Isn't this how it has always been before? So that was an important news story for me, because that is the beginning of the end. That's where you think you're at the top and people start doing things on their own with or without you. And all of a sudden, you gradually fade to insignificance on the world stage. That was writing on the wall for me when we were not leading that mission. Let's keep going. How about Brazil?
I think the first order of business is we've got to, the United States has got to be able to send people back to orbit and be able to transport people to the space station. That ability, we lost that ability with the retirement of the space shuttle. And so the United States is currently in the rather embarrassing position of having to buy rides from the Russians on the Soyuz, and they are charging a crazy amount of money. Yeah, exactly. I mean, being at the mercy of Putin is not a good thing. He's not known for his kindness. So basically, he's really pillaging the U.S. taxpayer for those rides. And now, we've got to restore American ability to transport astronauts with a domestic vehicle, and that's what we hope to do in about 2 years. And then,
here's what happened. In the 1960s, yes, we were at war with the Soviet Union, Cold War, and a little bit of hot war over in Southeast Asia. So we fear them because they put up Sputnik, which, by the way, people forget, was an emptied out casing of an intercontinental ballistic missile. And Sputnik it itself means fellow traveler, so it's all peaceful, but it was a ballistic missile head without explosives. So that was a signal, and we freaked in America. So NASA got founded on the fear factor of Sputnik. All right, so we then go to the moon on the fear factor that Russia will control high ground. Then we go to the moon, space enthusiasts say, oh, we're on the moon by 69, we'll be on Mars in another 10 years. They completely did not understand why we got to the moon in the first place. We were at war. Once we saw that Russia was not ready to land on the moon, we stopped going to the moon. That should not surprise anybody looking back on it. Meanwhile, however, that entire era galvanized the nation. Forget the war driver. It galvanized us all to dream about tomorrow, to think about.
In preparing for today, in the 1980s, there was almost zero commercial satellites launched in the United States. It's now, I'm told, around 10% and growing. What changed that this has become? Is that all SpaceX, or?
It's mostly SpaceX.
Mostly,
yeah,
SpaceX.
Yeah. So actually, before the fall of the Soviet Union, the United States used to launch a very high percentage of commercial satellites. In fact, the U.S. was the leader in commercial satellite launch. But with the fall of the Soviet Union, the Russian rocket industry was able to figure out how to be capitalist really fast. The USSR had invested so much money in rocket technology, they actually had really good rockets, and arguably the best rocket technology in the world at the time of the fall of the Soviet Union. So they were able to completely take the
the commercial launch market away from the United States. So the United States went from, within the course of really just a few years, from being the leader in commercial satellite launch to being non-existent virtually. And then the French with the Ariane, and with a little bit of help from Germany and Italy, put a ton of money into the Ariane 5 rocket, also a good rocket, and the world commercial launch market then became essentially divided between the Russians and the French, the Russians probably about having about 3/4 of the business and the French having about 1/4. And that continued on for quite a while until a few years ago when SpaceX started launching the Falcon 9. And since then, we've steadily increased the share of US-1 missions. And I think we're now about 1/4 of all commercial satellite missions are won by a US company, or really won by SpaceX. And I think that's, we've got a decent shot if we keep at it of achieving a majority of the commercial launch market, of winning over a majority of the commercial launch market. I don't want to count chickens before they've hatched, but it's looking, you know, increasingly positive. That will probably, you know, we'll probably restore the United States to number one on commercial launches in the world.
Fear they are likely to lose.
His success is in fact that he made the process less expensive. His rockets are to be used multiple times, therefore he doesn't have to build a new rocket every time, and the price is low. He can take a satellite into orbit cheaper, and we'll lose it in this competition because our rockets can be used only once.
Igor Korochenko is one of a number of deeply concerned Russian defense and space analysts. He's concerned for Russia's share of the space market and concerned SpaceX will benefit the US military. The workhorses of Russia's state space program, like the Soyuz here, suddenly feel like aging remnants from a different era, which they are, really. Soyuz first launched in 1966. A new cosmodrome called Vostochny in Russia's Far East has brought some modernization, but millions of dollars have gone missing from the accounts. The cosmodrome's corruption scandals highlight the country's problem with self-sabotage, even on projects of national...
Tell the people about Operation Paperclip, about how we went and got the German scientists, Wernher von Braun and his crowd, to come over here. The Soviets
so
took half
Wernher
of them.
Wernher von Braun invents rockets, basically.
The V2.
The V1 was not...
The buzz bomb.
The V2 was the first ballistic missile that leaves our atmosphere, goes into the vacuum of space, and comes back and hits its target. Yeah. He knew, even though this is deputized for warfare, that after the war, if you're going to go into space, you're going to need something like that. We knew that, too. We didn't put him on the line at Nuremberg, okay? We kept him,
right.
All right?
And the Russians stole other guys.
Russians got their German scientists, we got ours.
Yeah, the joke in the 1960s was, our German scientists are better than your
right, exactly.
scientists.
And so we got him to birth the Apollo program and design the rocket that would go to the moon. And so using his expertise that he used to terrorize London with the V2 rocket. This mm-hmm. this relationship goes deep.
My name is Anastasia.
I'll pop back all the way.
I would like to ask you the following thing. I'm Russian, and a lot of people here are from many different countries. You're going interplanetary, but you're not going international. When are you going to hire people from other countries than the US?
Yeah, so I think people are a bit confused about this. Unfortunately, this is not up to us. So the U.S. government regulations, they make getting a job in the U.S. hard as it is, just getting a job visa hard as it is. But if you're working on rocket technology, that's considered an advanced weapons technology. So even a normal work visa isn't sufficient unless you get a special permission from the Secretary of Defense or the Secretary of State. I want to be clear, this is not out of some desire of SpaceX to just hire people with green cards. It's because we're not allowed to do anything else. And I think this is not a wise thing for, this is not a wise policy for the U.S. because there's so many talented people all around the world that we would love to have work at our company, but unless unless they can somehow get a green card, we can't. We're legally prevented from hiring anyone.
So you got to have something that's gonna fire up the, fire people up and get them really excited. And like, I think if we had a serious goal of having a base on the moon and sending people to Mars, and said, okay, this is, we're gonna be outcome oriented. How are we gonna do this? Okay, we gotta change the way contracting is done. You can't do these like cost plus sole source contracts, because then the incentive structure is all messed up. So as soon as you don't have any competition, well, okay, there's no the sense of urgency goes away. And as soon as you make something a cost plus contract, you're incenting the contractor to maximize the costs of the program because they get a percentage. So they never want that gravy train to end, and they want to make it, they become cost maximizers. And then you have good people engaged in cost maximization because you just gave them incentive to do that and told them they'll get punished if they don't. Essentially, that's what happens. So it's critically important that we change the contracting structure to be a competitive commercial bid. Make sure that there are always at least two entities that are competing to serve NASA, and that the contracts are milestone based with concrete milestones. PowerPoint presentations do not count. Like everything works in PowerPoint. Okay, except I have a teleportation device. Look, here's my PowerPoint presentation. Milestone-based, competitive commercial contracts with competitors, and then you've got to be prepared to fire one of those competitors if they're not cutting it, and recompete the remainder of that contract. And by the way, NASA's actually already done this, and they did it with the commercial cargo transportation to the space station. And that was a case where NASA, that NASA actually, I'm not sure if they thought it would work or not work, but they didn't have the budget to do anything else. So they're like, okay, we're going to try this competitive commercial milestone-based contracting, and it worked great. And they awarded it to two companies, to SpaceX and a company called Kistler. And SpaceX managed to meet the milestones. Kistler did not, so then NASA recompeted the remainder of the contract to Orbital Sciences, but then Orbital Sciences got across the finish line. So now NASA's got two suppliers for taking cargo to the space station. We're forced to pay over $70 million per seat to the Russians just to go to the space station. And they have us over a barrel. And being at Putin's mercy is not a good place to be. So we want to restore the American ability to transport astronauts to the space station, maybe beyond someday, and do so as soon as possible. It's going to, I think, be a better product for a lot less money, and it's just kind of embarrassing that the United States has to thumb rides from the Russians.
Here we go, guys.
All right.
SpaceX has decided to file suit and protest the the Air Force ELV block buy. This is not SpaceX protesting and saying that these launches should be awarded to us. We're just protesting and saying these launches should be competed. And if we compete and lose, that's fine. But why were they not even competed?
Yeah, we'll only be doing the order.
I'm John Ehrlichman. SpaceX CEO Elon Musk took to Capitol Hill this morning to make a push to enter the Pentagon satellite launch market, all while sitting next to his biggest competitor. Bloomberg's Yang Yang joins us now from Capitol Hill. Yang, any sparks fly between the two rocket chiefs?
Yeah, you can certainly say that, John. Today we had Elon Musk, CEO of SpaceX, on Capitol Hill, making the point that he wants to join the military and spy satellite launch program that the federal government has. It's a big market, and right now it's dominated by United Launch Alliance. Today, Musk said that he was vying for a table. He was sitting next to ULA's CEO, Michael Gass, before the Senate Appropriations Subcommittee on defense. There he said that using SpaceX would save the federal government $1 billion, $1 billion in tax savings for taxpayers every year. And he did that while sitting next to his competitor and said that the current state of the market is unsustainable.
The Air Force and other agencies are simply paying too high a price for launch. The impacts of relying on monopoly providers since 2006 were predictable, and they have borne out. Space launch innovation has stagnated, competition has been stifled, and prices have risen to levels that General Shelton has called unsustainable.
At issue is the Air Force's EELV program, which stands for Evolved Expendable Launch Vehicle Program. It's a $70 billion program that's the federal government's answer for reducing the cost of military satellite launches. Now, right now, that's dominated by United Launch Alliance because SpaceX, although it's trying to get a spot in that certification program, doesn't have the approval to do so, meaning that ULA has for years held the monopoly. It's a joint venture between defense giants Lockheed Martin and Boeing. And today the CEO, Michael Gass, said that he doesn't think that breaking up that monopoly in the name of competition will really have that big of a payoff. Take a listen.
I believe there are important questions about how EELV competitions will be structured to ensure they are fair and open, and whether competition will actually save the savings that is promised. Ultimately, the central question is whether savings from competition will be sufficient to offset the cost of duplicating existing capabilities.
Luckily, that's a sentiment that's not shared by the Pentagon. They will later this year be opening up 14 more missions for new entrants like SpaceX to take a stab at entering that market. And John, lawmakers today seem to echo that sentiment as well.
Interesting. Any talk about Russia today? I know that he told our Rachel Crane, it's embarrassing the U.S. has to thumb rides to Russia. Did that come up at all?
Yeah, in fact, it did. So one thing that Musk was sure to point out in his testimony was that United Launch Alliance, their rockets actually use an engine that is actually manufactured in Russia. So seizing on everything that's happening right now, seizing on the proposed economic sanctions, all of that, he made the point of saying that to him, it's crazy that the United States would consider awarding millions, hundreds of millions of dollars in contracts to United Launch Alliance, not opening up for competition when he at SpaceX, he is able to say that everything that they produce is actually made in the USA. So that was one point that he did capitalize on today. John?